Chapter 42, A Broken Mind. "You do not look quite yourself, my dear," Mira called back. "How can I be sure it's you? Your face, your skin, your voice. You have grown inexplicably more handsome." The patronizing laugh, as Matt returned, might have been rougher and more troll-like than she remembered, but it was unmistakably his own. A column of iron trees came crashing down around her, surrounding her like a fence. The ground buckled beneath her for a moment, but didn't throw her. The crag and the dragon descended, flying down to meet her in slow circles. "Have you grown tired of our old game, dear?" he shouted. The trees writhed and shook in a ring around her as she waited. They seemed to want to leave, to be anywhere instead of here. She could relate. She held her pan flute close to her face with a steady hand, ready for her turn to make a play, waiting for Azmat to show himself. Killing the dragon and the already dead crag would accomplish little if she couldn't find and kill him. "There was a time I couldn't get you to leave the house," Azmat crooned. "I was more than your husband. I was your father, your mother, your friends, your children. I was everything and everyone you cared about. When did that end? When did it all go so wrong?" Miara's frown deepened into a scowl. "When the cracks in the lie became more frightening than the lie itself," she said. "There comes a time when you have to acknowledge there is not enough gold paint in the world to replace the golden past." "It was a reliable lie," he pointed out. "I maintained it for centuries, even after my only worshipper lost faith." "Even after you knew the truth, you'd sometimes slip into believing the lie again for the sheer pleasure of it." "You cannot judge me by my weakest moments," she turned away. He dismounted from the dragon, and she prepared to slap him if he got too near. Instead, he circled her like a wolf, enormous eyes sliding up and down her body with deadly hunger. To kill her would bring him power, perhaps even greater power. Killing the last of a race was a great evil. So was killing a wife. "Your weakest moments," he circled, "are my strongest ones. Isn't that how a marriage works? "You cannot pretend our marriage was balanced," she hissed, eyes following him, "that we were somehow equal." "Pretending together is what we do best," Azmat laughed. "How am I to blame if you aren't as invested in the pretending as I am?" "Oh, but this is silliness. What trivialities a domestic argument can reduce us to. Do you still want an equal share of my power?" She began her song. The first few notes seemed to steal the grin from the crag's face. "It is a matter of making us even," she spat. "Or if it is a matter of making us even," she spat, "I would prefer to share a bit of my power with you." With a flurry of bright ascending notes, she wove a protective field around herself. Azmat grinned and leaned his crag body against the magical wall, leering at her. The wall itself was invisible, but sparks erupted and fell like autumn leaves from where the crag flesh touched the magic. "Ah," he said, "so you do feel guilty about killing my daughter." She frowned and played faster. "I know what you're thinking," he added. "I didn't kill her. She was already dead. You probably killed her." He was trying to distract her. He must be. But what was he trying to distract her from? The dragon? Tearing her eyes away from the crag, she made a quick circle of her field of force, scanning her surroundings. The wyvern stood still, watching her intently. I have the might of the entire elven race behind me, Azmat, Miara declared, cutting his rambling off as she finished her sweep. You cannot hide from me forever behind corpses and accusations. The smile on the troll's face widened. Miara smiled back, racking her brain for a way to force his hand. What if she loosed the leather gag from off the dragon's maw? Would the dragon's song reach Azmat through the crag's ears? Would the wyvern be quick enough to take advantage of the opportunity? She would need to weave a spell to protect her own ears first, without Azmat noticing, and then play the notes to untie the gag. She needed a moment to think, to prepare. Something cold and unyielding wrapped around her bare ankle. She faltered mid-song. Black metal fingers, bones, gripped her skin, freezing her to the spot. She heard a scream, one that seemed to come from high above her. She couldn't tear her eyes away from the ground as her husband's fleshless face pushed its way up out of the soil. The dragon exploded. Husband and wife turned in surprise as the wyvern erupted in a fountain of pure light. Blinking, Miara could just make out the creature's flattened form as the light faded. Every bone was broken if it wasn't shattered, and blood leaked from a torn and tattered skin. In the center of the crushed monster was a wide-eyed goblin, a Gloin, she was pretty sure. He lay on his side, a glowing rod clenched in two fists in front of him, his chest heaving like a bellows as he sucked in panicked breaths. He was covered in hot, steaming blood, but none of it was his own. How far had he fallen? And yet somehow he lived? This was no time to wonder. Azmat was distracted, if only for a moment longer. She tapped a short, haunting tune on the pipe's ends of her pan flute with swift fingers. Under her power, Azmat's body launched from the ground beneath her like a crossbow bolt, his fingers tearing her skin like knives as he passed. She fell to one knee but kept the tune going. The dark metal bones collided into the crag as her field of force dissipated. Rather than collapsing into a heap together, though, the crag's flesh seemed to absorb them. The black metal pressed deep into the crag's skin as if it was clay. The crag's bones pushed out the back and fell into an untidy pile behind the troll, a skeleton still wet from its host. Azmat stretched his new arms and cracked his knuckles with an unsettling snap. He was smaller than the crag whose flesh he'd stolen, so the gray skin hung off him in wrinkled folds. His face was especially saggy, like a melting mask, blood leaking from the mismatched orifices. Azmat had to reach up and tug on the eyelids to expose his startling blue eyes. "Too much, don't you think?" he drawled past massive, drooling lips. Mira fought hard to keep back her bile. A heavy, lilting tune stitched her ankle back together so she could stand. He was trying to keep her off balance, trying to distract her with nightmares and abominations. Well, she had her own nightmare to fight back with. "Chaotic," she ordered, "show yourself." The Wyvern could see nothing at first. A flash of red, and then it felt as though where once he'd had 100 eyes, now he had none. None at all. A single point of light shone in the distance. He made his way over, little thinking how he was moving without legs or wings. When he arrived, the point of light turned out to be a hole. On the other side of the hole was a bright light full of everything, every color he could remember. If he could just squeeze in, he shook himself or herself. This was definitely a herself. She was that Wyvern held, the phage he had captured at the square. The Wyvern felt so small, but by human standards, he knew this was a large woman, sturdy and well-built. But she would need to get used to this. There was grass in her face and the smell of elephant dung in the air. She got up and looked around. Yes, she was an Eltar. She licked some dust off of the coppery brown skin of her arm, then spat. Yes, definitely, Eltar. She jumped up and down for a moment, experimenting with the body's strength. The Wyvern couldn't sense any of the rest of the Wyvern held, or her old center, the dragon she used to be. She must be stuck now. Azmat must have killed her, and her mind had gone spinning off in 100 or so pieces. She needed to regroup to find the rest of her. No, what good would that do? They would all remember who killed him, and they could still sing, couldn't they? She tried to sing. The notes wouldn't come. Of course, the song had come from her old dragon blood, from the source of her power. Without the dragon at the center, there was no power at the edge. Still, this wasn't just any Wyvern held. This woman had been a phage. She could draw power from the planet itself and use it to perform great feats. She was Slaan-blessed in a way the Wyvern race, as creatures of Zakotek and Brimson, had never been. She started walking south. The plan was unchanged. Azmat needed to die. She should come up with a name to help differentiate her from the other Wyvern held once they met up, though. She cycled through a few options. Brigadorn, Glumburn, Balthus, Thrawn. No, those were too obvious. The other pieces of the Wyvern mind would think of those first, just as she did. Which was a shame. They were some of her favorite dragon names. If only she knew what this human's name had been before she'd possessed her. She let out a cold laugh. If only she knew what the other versions of her were doing back at the castle. If only she could be there to maintain order. Well, that was a ridiculous sentiment. She was here. Or she was there, and yet she wasn't. This would take some getting used to. The Wyvern could see nothing at first. A flash of red, and then it felt as though there was once... as though where once he'd had 100 eyes, now he had none. None at all. A single point of light shone in the distance. He made his way over, little thinking how he was moving without legs or wings. When he arrived, the point of light turned out to be a hole. Well, on the other side of the hole was a bright light full of every color he could remember. If he could just squeeze in. He blinked. This room looked familiar. Dark. But his eyes were already adjusted to that. Besides, it was the smell that tickled his memories the most. Long, decayed flesh. Wasn't one of his Wyvern held here just a moment ago, cleaning the trap rooms while he was watching Azmat and the elf fight? Oh, of course. He must be dead, the dragon part of him, anyway. Odd that he was here, in one of the Wyvern held's bodies. Or was he in all of them? A piece of his mind in every living body that had been under his control when he died? Only one way to find out. He pushed himself up on his hands and knees and wiped cobwebs off his cheek. Human skin was so sensitive. It felt even more so now, since this single body was all the skin he had. He jumped up and down, but he had to stop as soon as he started. Off balance and out of breath already? This must be one of the older Wyvern held. He grabbed a handful of his own beard and held it up to his face. Old gray whiskers. This body had nearly run its course. Come to think of it, had he been taking this one to out to clean the trap rooms or to finish himself off? He couldn't recall. Well, too late now. He'd have to make do. It was time to see if he could find himself or other pieces of himself. The castle was so full of Wyvern held, and he could remember, if he thought about it, where each one had been the moment before he died. He found the staircase and started to climb. It took way too long. He had to stop and rest on the flagstone steps part way up, wheezing and coughing and holding onto the wall just to stay upright. No, the other Wyvern held would be much faster than him. They'd probably all meet in the courtyard. That was the most suitable, sensible place. He crawled up the last few steps to get to the second floor balcony. It would be hard, keeping up with all the rest of the Wyvern held. He needed to find some way to prove his worth to the rest. He took a deep breath before pushing open the door to the courtyard. It was time to appear confident, prepared, even fearsome if he could manage it. He set his face into a rigid mask, then shoved the door aside and stepped onto the raised platform above the courtyard. The tiled expanse below him, beneath him, was covered in the dead and the dying. Crossbow bolts whined past from the surrounding walls, sinking deep into Wyvern held flesh in every corner of the castle. One thunked into the wooden door next to the old man Wyvern, pushing him back into the shelter of the doorway. More Wyvern held were fighting on the roof of the keep with spears and shields. What was happening? They needed to band together if they were going to get revenge on Asmet for letting them die like this. Weren't any other Wyvern held docile enough to accept a leader? He looked down at his worn, weak human body. If only he was strong enough to wade into this melee and assert his dominance. But no, that must have been what all the rest thought too. None of them were followers. They were all the Wyvern. They were accustomed to being in complete, uncontested control. None would accept a leader willingly. He backed into the hallway and leaned against the wall with a sigh. Where would he be safe? He couldn't leave the castle. The fields outside the keep would be a killing field right now, with all the crossbowmen vying for dominance. There must be somewhere in this house of theirs that would remain safe and untouched. Of course, the brood. Their lair would be left alone. Perhaps they would even offer the old man Wyvern some protection. He would need to be careful, though. There might be other Wyvern held who had the same idea. He made his way north along the red-carpeted hallway. Should he grab a weapon from one of the closets? No, it would do no good. He was too tired and weak to use a spear, and it might even make him seem like a threat. It was best to keep a low profile as much as the need irked him. His Clist would help him. They were always more merciful than him, more prone to sentimental weakness. He picked up the pace as he could, almost tripping over his tired legs. No wonder he'd been on the verge of killing this body off. How long had he been enchanted, anyway? 30 years? 40? The old man Wyvern stopped short. There was a stairway leading down to where the brood lived, at the northern wing of the keep, but the door to the landing was blocked, and not by a Wyvern held. Wyvern or human, the Drakenfex signed with his free hand. The other hand held a blowgun to his lips, loaded and ready. He was a very young Drakenfek, with dark, almost black skin and wary dark eyes on an expressionless face. What sort of proof was he expecting? The Wyvern put his hands above his head. The Drakenfek knew he understood their language. He'd tried to infiltrate them more than once with well-placed Wyvern held, so he'd had to learn it fluently. If he pretended not to understand, maybe that would be enough. "I'm harmless, child," he promised. "No threats here. What is going on?" Acting. He'd spent 100 years practicing his acting so he could infiltrate human societies and convince them he wasn't worth fighting. Now it was the only thing standing between escape and certain death. The Drakenfek was still watching him. "Please try to understand me," the Wyvern begged. "I woke up here just a few minutes ago. I don't know where I am. I don't know why there are men and women fighting outside. I'm just looking for a place to hide. Do you understand?" That was close enough to the truth to maybe allay the man's suspicions. It was possible someone could have broken the possession curse for this old man's body in the moments before the Wyvern's death, or after it. Unlikely, but possible. The Drakenfek lowered his blowgun and signed, "What is your name?" The Wyvern just barely remembered not to answer. Answering would give away he understood the man's language. "What is that you're doing with your hands, child?" he asked. "You're not." "Oh, of course. You're Drakenfek, aren't you?" The Drakenfek hesitated before nodding. "Well, that makes no sense. What would you be doing here in Southern Ra? Or are we in Phylos?" The Wyvern chuckles weakly. "I'm afraid I don't remember much. I don't even remember growing this old. Oh, and now I'm rambling." The Drakenfek shook his head as the Wyvern trailed off. He handed the old man a piece of parchment. The Wyvern was astonished at how far-sighted his eyes were as he struggled to make out the flowing handwriting. It only took him a few moments to realize the effort was pointless. How had he not killed this wyvern and held off sooner? "I'm sorry, son," he apologized, handing the note back. "I can't read that. I don't have my scene pieces. No idea where it went, either." The Drakenfect folded the note and returned it to his pocket in his cloak, then signaled for the old man wyvern to wait a minute. It wasn't long before the wyvern could hear footsteps on the stairs below. Someone was coming, and it couldn't be a Drakenfect. You couldn't hear a Drakenfect, and these footfalls sounded familiar. With difficulty, he masked his face while his clist came through the door. Their hands were behind them, but their wrists weren't tied. A second Drakenfect followed, longbow drawn and arrow knocked, but the arrow wasn't aimed at the clist. After seeing the first Drakenfect, the wyvern had expected his clist to be dead. Failing that, he'd expected to see them captured and taken away. He wasn't sure whether he was relieved or horrified to see them leaving willingly without a fight, and perhaps even of their own volition. There were four women and one man. Two of the women were very pregnant. "Who is this?" asked Karn, the taller of the two pregnant clist. Karn's baby would be the second dragonborn in Duskane if all went well. She was especially tall for an Eltar, with stringy, muscular limbs. The wyvern was proudest of her after Marga. He couldn't show that now, though. They couldn't know who he was. The Drakenfect was signing for him, for them. Oris, the only male clist, nodded and translated for the rest of them. When had he learned Drakenfect? That was odd. "He's saying this might be a wyvern held, who was freed just before the confusion outside started," Oris explained. "He's not quite sure, though. The story's just a little too convenient." Oris was short but confident, straight-backed and broad-shouldered, with just enough fat to round him out a bit. "More than a little convenient, actually," Oris continued. "It's the exact story I would expect from Father, if he was stuck in a human body as decrepit as that one." The wyvern found himself wishing he could eat the human again, but of course he couldn't. He wasn't a dragon anymore, and these clists were all he had left. "Would you perhaps like to add to your story, Father?" Whistle, the second pregnant woman, asked. "Give it a touch more drama, something to tug your children's heartstrings." Her strident voice was almost as annoying as her condescending tone. She was beautiful, though, for a human. Straight white hair and a face paler than milk. Old Felosian blood, that. Before the wyvern could come up with a response, the two last clists spoke. Why let him lie to us now?" they spoke as one. "His traps and tricks are done, his body is destroyed, and what is left is only a frail copy of the wyvern who was. He has no power over us." The twins had always adored him, or so he thought. Meki and Muki were identical in every way, a strange fluke in his reproductive process. He'd eaten one red-haired human child, and two clists had come from it. Strange, but not unheard of. At the time, what had struck him as more important was their power, the ability to read the souls of everyone and everything around them. That was not a normal draconic power. It seemed to defy both magic and religion. He'd looked forward to decades of experimenting with the limits of their abilities. And now they were to be his downfall. The Drakenfect both raised their weapons. The wyverns tried to sing, but notes wouldn't come. What a shame. If he could have possessed Sans Clist as he had Marga, he might yet have survived this treachery. "Wait," Whistle shouted, raising a hand toward the old man wyvern. The Drakenfect didn't turn at her shout, but they did turn for her downturned palm. "If anyone should kill Father," she declared, "it should be his children." The wyvern actually laughed. The laugh turned into a hacking cough, but it was a laugh nonetheless. Tears streamed down his eyes. "You think you can kill me?" he wheezed. "I am everywhere. I have wyvern held in place all over Duskane. Killing this old body accomplishes nothing." "Perhaps," Karen admitted. Blood flame licked the corners of her mouth as she continued, "but every little bit hurts." She aimed straight for his heart. A numb tingling spread through the old man's body as he fell to the red carpeted stone. Then it was over.